Guys, do you have any questions regarding last session?
No, I don't have any.
Okay, thank you. Guys, last session. Yeah, so last session we discussed about so this AnyPoint Studio. So what are all the parts in AnyPoint Studio? We discussed about palette and we discussed about this console also. So in the console, so you can see here, so all the server logs, guys, whenever you try to deploy your application. So you can see all the server logs. If you are facing any issues also, you can see here. See, these are the server logs. By default, your application will deploy in the Jetty server. So there is already by default, it will come up with the AnyPoint Studio. No need to add any plugin for this. These are server logs. Suppose anything goes wrong in your application. So here error log will display, guys. So based on that, we need to rectify that one. So there is a console here. So you can see all the info. This is by default we'll get it actually. If you keep any logger also, that logger also will display here. If you keep in your application, so if you drag and drop any logger like this, so that logger also will display in the console itself. Okay, so that is about console. So end of the console will get this deployment status actually. If it is status is deployed, so your application is successfully deployed. This is application name. And then so domain default, we'll discuss about domain actually. Domain means, already I was saying about a little bit about that domain in the sense, so if you create an application in the muleproject.xml, you will get a domain name here, guys. So I told about domain little bit. So if you want to create a common things for 10 applications, suppose I'm creating a 10 applications, so that there is a common application for all the 10 applications, means common properties I want to define for all the 10 applications. That time here we create a domain project, that domain here will show here, guys. Here automatically the domain project will come, that will refer it actually. As of now there is no domain project in my workspace, so the domain name is not coming here. So if you create a domain project, that automatically coming here will refer that one. So that time, so when you deploy your application successfully, you can see here a domain name also. As of now it's a default. If you are not creating any domain project, so that will come as a default. So next one is status is deployed, guys. Okay, so this means your application is successfully deployed. Based on that you need to execute your application. So next level. Okay, so this is about console, and coming to here, there is one more tab, is the mule debugger. This mule debugger is while running your application in a debug mode. So how to debug your application? I'm just stopping the server here. Shortcut also there, guys. You can stop here also, and then so right click on your application. So then there is an option called debug as mule application. If you run a debug as mule application, your application will run in a debug mode. Okay, the difference is, see, this dialog will pop up, guys, while running a debug mode. So do you want to open this perspective now? Perspective means actually, if you click yes, it will change the appearance of this even AnyPoint Studio actually. Here in Eclipse or else AnyPoint Studio, so we can see different perspectives actually. So if you see here, so now earlier will look like this, your AnyPoint Studio is look like this. If you choose and debug mode, so the perspective got changed actually, the look and feel so got changed. That is nothing but perspective. You can see so many perspective actually. If you click here plus symbol, can you see here, right? So if you click a plus symbol, you can see multiple perspectives actually. If you want to see the Java perspective, you can click Java. So mail debug, mail design. So like that we have a different types of perspective. Whatever the perspective you want to see, if you just click here, so that will appear like this. Okay, so that is about debug mode. What is the difference between normal mode and debug mode? So if you want to stop your processes, suppose you are trying to run your application, I want to stop at payload level. So there is a debug point here. So that is nothing but right click on the particular component, whatever the message processor, you can drag and drop. There is an option called toggle breakpoint, guys. So click on the toggle breakpoint, so it will enable the debug breakpoint here actually. Okay, if you choose here, so you can see the debug breakpoint also here. In the debug mode, we can see mail breakpoints. We kept only one breakpoint, so that's why it's coming here. If you want to remove breakpoint, you can right click on the particular component or processor, so select toggle breakpoint again, it will remove it. Or else there is another option is, so you can go here and directly you can remove all breakpoints. Or else if you want to disable it, you can disable it, guys, but I don't want to enable the debug mode, so just there is a checkbox here, you can disable it, that one. So what was the purpose of this debug mode? So while developing an application, that is important, guys, step by step you can trace it actually. So what was happening exactly? In the first step, you are getting the data or not. In the second step, so generally before hitting database, what data you are going to hit the database. After hitting the database, what data you are getting from the database. So that level you can check it actually in the debug mode while developing time actually. Okay, that is the use of debug mode. So as a developer, we always run in a debug mode. So any application. So that is about debug mode. So next one is here, coming to here, this is a package, guys. I will explain the package also, what are the parts in the each application. If you try to create an application,
Venkat, I have one question.
Yeah,
instead debug mode, once the process completed, can't we see the all logs at one place instead in the MMU that
we can see in console now.
No, actually you put the breakpoint here, so
yes.
To check the some request and the response and its log. Instead that okay, we completed hold the process, hold the
yes.
Process completed after process completed, can't we check the like request XML, response XML, like that by clicking the each and every activity here? Like when we click the set payload, can't we find input what passed to the set payload, and can't we find the response?
See, that's what here. Suppose I will try to run once again this debug mode. See, once this process is complete, we can't hold that one actually. So if your debug mode is kept there, that time only you can hold that information. There is one more symbol here. There is a mule evaluate expression, there is a symbol is the right side of that. You can open that pop-up, you can check it actually. Suppose here in the debug mode, here actually right side one symbol, one pop-up will come actually, that will come in the running mode only. I will try to check this one.
Venkat, can you run that application? We'll see what normally.
Can you see my screen? I'm running the application.
Venkat, I have a quick question here.
Yeah.
Under this console, immediately you see a path over there. program files, Java, JDK, blah, blah, blah. If I take this path and put it in asynchronous mode and push this to a file, I can have the log of this thing. Can I do that?
So where is that? Where is that, whatever you are saying? Where is that path?
C program files, Java, JDK 1.8.0, so and so.
Okay, that is the Java path it was showing.
That's what this is, where the console log is, like what all you are seeing is in this file. If I put this file in asynchronous mode and push this content to a separate file, so I'll get the log of this thing.
Where will you? So where will get? I'm not getting what you're saying. Asynchronous. What is the meaning of that?
What is asynchronous? If I want to transfer a file from two between two folders, okay, this is synchronous. This is what I want to get it done immediately. Asynchronous is something which is not important right now, but it has to happen. Okay, by putting asynchronous, I push this content to a file in a folder. Can that be done?
That's what we need to drag and drop, that asynchronous component we have to do. Otherwise, how will do it?
And that's what I was asking.
Yeah, you can do that one. We can keep that is already explained in the last session. You are there in the last session. I was clearly saying what is asynchronous, what is synchronous, how will do it at asynchronous, so that we can achieve it. No issue in that.
No. Somebody was asking about the log. So I thought this would be a better way to have the log in a file.
You can do it. Okay, so coming to other question, so somebody asked about this question. See this, actually in the, so now I stopped its payload level. So you can see here there is a symbol is there. So that is a evaluate mule expression. So there is a concept called mule expression language, MEL, mule expression language. So here there is a symbol will come, x plus y equals something. So if you click some this symbol, one pop-up will come in actually. So you can see what data we are getting from the in this step, in particular step. So before the payload we are getting null actually. If you see here, we are getting null. So you are saying like after processing, how we hold the data. So you can see the only logs actually. After that we can't able to see the data. Now we can see the payload. I'm getting payload as a path display. So because here I'm just holding that. So here I'm just get the path of that, what you are requesting from the browser. I'm capturing that path actually. So that I'm holding here. So now process is completed. There is an option called resume. So there is a step by step. If you want to see, there is a F6 is the shortcut, or else you can click the shortcut symbol, or else F6 step by step you can see, or else resume. If you don't want to stop anywhere, click resume. So it will complete come outside. Now I am clicking resume. So it's came outside actually. So now, so you can see only in the logs actually. Can see only in the logs, we can't able to hold that data anywhere else. So now tell me, what was your question? Processing is completed, but we can't hold the data here. I can't able to see in the debug mode. I can see only in the logs.
Yeah, Venkat, that's what I want actually to see the data. Yeah, you explained. Yeah, I wanted to see the data.
Yeah, you can see there is a symbol called. So I was thinking like while debugging time, I was trying to say about that's mule expression language. Anyway, you asked now itself. Okay, you are clear. Right? So coming back to here, I just stop this. Yeah, tell me.
Venkat, we can add n number of toggle points or just one toggle point?
No, as you wish.
So if it is in the flow, like from where it starts the debugging, from which toggle point?
In process. These are two parts. The two parts I said, right? One is inbound location, outbound location, right? So these are input. You can see these are HTTP input. After that, output. Here also you can keep it actually. So but If you see, this is a HTTP connector actually, here we can't keep it. Sometimes you know there is other components like pool component, if we keep it, that time you can keep it actually. There is no restriction, so generally it's not required, right? If you place one, if you keep it one place, if we click F6 next time, no need to keep anywhere else, right? Step by step it will go. You understand?
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yes. Then what is the use of then what is the use of keeping multiple tuple points?
That's what, that is not required, I'm saying. If you see, here also I'm keeping multiple, one more. So, if you if you run the application, it will come anywhere here. If you try to click F6, it will come obviously here. No need to keep any toggle breakpoint here. So, see, multiple when it is required actually. Suppose I don't want to run in a step by step. I want to run in a exactly where I kept the breakpoint, that it should go. So that time you can keep multiple breakpoints. Suppose here if I kept F8, I mean a breakpoint, first it will come here. Don't press the F6, press F8. It will jump to directly wherever you kept the debug point, it will go there next time.
Oh, we need to press the F8?
Yes.
Okay guys,
so that is about your question. I'm trying to explain the what are the structure of your project, guys. I'm trying to create a new project, then I will try to explain the structure of the project. So there is an option called file, guys. I'm trying to create a new project. Before that, I was clearly explaining so how to configure the AnyPoint Studio and how to set the workspace also. Workspace in the is nothing but, so if you create a project, your project will go and store there actually. That is a workspace. So by default, if you're not creating any workspace, by default any omission, so C drive users based on the computer name or else your username, right? That location, it will create all the projects. Or else if you want to create a separate workspace, you can create it and then you can switch the workspace actually. There is an option called switch workspace. Go to file and then switch workspace. You can click other, show the path wherever you create the your workspace, show the workspace. Then accordingly it will open a workspace. You can work on that actually. So there is a change workspace and then I'm like, now I'm creating a new project, file, new. There is a mule project. You can create Java project, domain project, any project you can create it, guys. Not only mule project here, this AnyPoint Studio will support Java project also. Now, so I'm just creating mule demo is my project. Observe here, guys. This was, I was already talking about this mule server 3.8.3 enterprise edition. So how it will come here? So before that we should we need to add the runtime, guys. This is nothing but a runtime actually. Runtime in the sense, so whenever you are trying to deploy your application, that will go and deploy into the standalone server. So this is a standalone server. Now I am using standalone server latest version, that is nothing but a 3.8.3. So suppose any client or else any project, if you are using any other version like 3.7.0, because people will use whatever the stable versions, people will use only stable versions actually. Suppose 3.7.0 is stable version, then if you want to use that one, you have to add the 3.7.0 plugin, guys. So then while creating a new project, you have to choose that particular mule runtime server. Is it clear, right? So you can add multiple things, not only 3.8.3. I want to use 3.8.0 sometime, I want to use 3.7.0 sometimes. You can add multiple servers whenever you are trying to create a project. So that time you have to choose that particular runtime. Okay, so that is the way we should add these guys, otherwise you can't able to create the project. That's a mandatory thing. So next one is here. So we can create different types of projects, not only normal mule domain mule project. We can create Maven project. There is an option called Maven project. So there is an option called add API kit components, guys. So using RAML, this is a RAML actually, we'll discuss in future session. So how to create a Maven project, how to create a API kit, that means API projects, we'll create it. I'll discuss in future. As of now, I'm trying to create a normal build project, guys. So you can see here your Java versions, your location, everything is coming here. I'm ignoring all the as a default. Next. Finish it. Yeah, tell me.
And then I have a question like that. Mm-hmm. Before you said that we can add multiple servers in the project list.
For a single application, not multiple servers.
Only
project. Here we can add multiple servers, I'm saying. But while creating a project, we have to choose only one server. You understood?
Okay, then how can I add another server to your runtime?
Same way.
That's what.
Last session you were there, right? Install new software, search for a particular server, add it.
Okay.
Here, search for, keep it all available websites, and then search for server here. You can see list of servers here. Just add it.
Okay.
Multiple servers you can add, no issue. It was trying to search, picking the multiple servers, picking all the servers. See? And you see here multiples are there now, so you can choose that, you can add it. Actually I just choose one, 3.6.1. so just click next and restart your any points to do, then it will come there actually automatically. Okay, now that is the way to add. So coming back to here, your project structure,
I have a small question.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, you said we can have multiple servers, right? These are all updated versions, or these are different softwares?
You can see all the versions. 3.8.3 is the latest.
Latest. And before softwares, all the features included in the latest software, right?
Right.
So, what is the use of old software, previous softwares?
That's what I'm trying to say. So suppose earlier, 1 year back, 2 years back, people did a project, right? Suppose that some enhancement came. There's earlier project is 3.5.0 they worked on. So some enhancement came, right? So you should work on 3.5.0. There is no choice, right? That's why you have to add the 3.5.0, then accordingly you have to work it. You understood? You understood what I'm saying? So now even my company also, still we are using 3.7.0. I want to do some enhancement, or else I have to do some work, patch work on that. I have to use 3.7.0, right? So now, so that's an older version. Now 3.8.3 also came.
So if you want to create application now onwards,
that's what actually. So that should decided by our client, right? Not ourselves. So they have to decide it. So if we create a 3.8.3, but they are using 3.7.0, some clash will come. How it will come? So they have servers maintained by client, right? Not ourselves. So their servers are pointing to 3.7.0. Suppose if you are creating a project in 3.8.3, so sometimes it won't work, right? You understood? So that is the problem. So that's why whatever the version suggested by architect, right? So onshore architect, our architect. So they should know that actually what are the servers client was maintaining. So same version we have to work on it actually. So that is the thing.
Okay,
so this is a project structure, guys. So once you create the project, so these are the folders we'll get it actually. So you can see here, first folder is SRC main app. So this is a folder we'll get it. In this SRC main app, under that we can keep all the flows, guys. So as of now, nothing is there in the flow, but there is some XML is generated back in. So here we can drag and drop the things. Okay. So like this, we can create multiple flows. You can keep it here, guys. Under the SRC main app, you can keep it one by one flow. You can create manually also flow. By default, we are getting Mule Demo XML. I want to create one more configuration file. We can call it as a configuration file. So there is an option called configuration file, Mule configuration file. So we can create so one more configuration file here. I'll just give it as test. Actually, automatically XML will come. You can write the description also. What was the purpose of that? Okay, see here, like that we can create a multiple XML file. So here if you observe in the bracket, they mention the flows guys. So why they mention the flows in earlier version like 3.1, 3.2, 3.3. So in that, in place of SRC main app, so directly they mention a flows, FLWS flows. There is a folder under that flows, they kept a flows actually. So that's why, so whoever worked on the earlier, might be they will get confused actually. So that's why, so the SRC main app is the latest package name. So in the bracket, they mention the flows. So that is a use of that flows actually. So here we can keep it a multiple XMLs guys. There is no restriction how many number of XML if you want to create it. You can create it accordingly, you can work on it. So next one is mule app.properties guys. So what was a mule app.properties? And then mule deploy.properties. So coming to mule app.properties, so here, so if you mention any value here, that should be under class path guys. Generally in the Java, if you want to keep any class path, we have to push in the class path actually. You have to right click on this and that, and then you have to push into the class path actually. But here I want to use some content in the in my XML. So suppose username equal some mule and then password equal mule 123 attempted. So what was the use of this? If you keep it, so whatever you kept the content, so that will come automatically so into the class path of this project guys. So that is a mule app.properties generally. So if you're working in a project, okay, once you've done your local development, you have to push into the multiple environments, right? Like once you've done, you have to give it to the QA people. So there is a separate environment maintained by the client. So you have to push your changes to the QA. That is a QA environment. Next level might be UAT, BAT, then finally production, or else there is an environment called stage. Like that, based on the client, we have several environments are there. So now now I am in a local. So now username is mule and again password is mule123. Think like this. There is a, I'm trying to connect to the one of the database that is in my local. The username is mule and password is mule123. So now in my local everything is working because of I'm talking to the local database. In my machine itself, there is a Oracle or else MySQL database is there. So I am passing dynamically this username and password to the my service, my XML, then it will talk to the my local database, it will fetch the information. So now once you've done your local, you need to push the QA environment. Okay, so once you push the QA environment, might be username and password will get changed, right? It should not mule 123, right? Might be it will change, but if you see this username and password key is the same, but value might be changed, right? So that's why if now we have to change, might be username also mule 123 in the QA environment, right? So that time you need to change only this file, no need to change this key actually. Now what happened if you deploy this in a QA environment? So that will talk to the whatever the database in the QA environment, it will talk there, so then it will fetch the information. So what I'm trying to say here, so we should not hard code anywhere guys in the configuration. We should not hard code it because these type of issues will come. If you hard code it, that will work only that specific environment. If you push to next environment or else some other environment, it should not work because you hard coded the content actually. So every time you should pass dynamically. So when you pass the dynamically, the data, it should fetch some property file, right? That is a property file is of this actually, we'll update properties file. This is the one way to get the properties, I mean, whatever the username and password, whatever the content you want to get dynamically, that you can mention under MuleApp.properties. That is the one way. Another way is, now if you see earlier Mule, now I changed manually Mule 1, 2, 3. This is also not fair, guys. So what we'll do, so you can keep it whatever the information you want to get dynamically, you can keep it MuleApp.properties, or else there is a src main resources, one more location is there, guys. Whatever the content is, either it's a media content like some images I want to use in my application, or else some other files like static files, JSON file, or else XML files. So whatever the content you want to use, static content, you can keep it under src main resources. That is one thing. Another thing is, so you can create several external properties file, guys. As of now, I have only one properties file. So every time I'm changing, now Mule is in my local environment. Mule 1, 2, 3 is, it's a pointing to QA environment. Might be production is something else. We need to, every time we are changing that properties file. That should not happen actually. So how it will work exactly, here in the SRC main resources, you can create multiple environments for properties file, guys. There is a property file, you can create it actually. So how we'll create it, there is a dev.properties. Okay, so dev.properties. Similarly, you can create a production.properties file. Like that, you can create multiple properties file, guys. So each environment you can create separate file. So there is a dev, GA, and then EAT, BAT, and then finally production. Here you can keep it actually. In future, no need to change that existing thing actually. Suppose you are talking to production environment, you can keep it here directly, username equal, it's related to production. That is a prod mule. Okay. So wherever in which your application is deployed in prod environment, it will only talk to the prod.properties. Your application is deployed in dev environment, it will talk to the dev.properties. Like that, it will happen, guys. But how it will identify either it's a prod environment or else a dev environment, so that will decided by this muleproject.xml, guys. So here, if you see here is the environment variables actually. If you see here, we place the data under mule app.properties, right? Username equal 1234 and then password equal mule 123. So that will come automatically here actually. But here we should keep environment specific actually. That is just click plus env equal some dev I mentioned actually. But I just hard coded as a dev, but it should not happen. There is a placeholder concept is there. While doing that time, I will explain clearly. So based on the placeholder, suppose I'm in a dev environment, it will automatically pick a dev.properties file, guys. If you are in a prod environment, if you automatically pick prod.properties file. So that type of intelligence is there, it will pick automatically, guys. So that is about this mule app.properties. So any questions on this? Guys, any questions on the environment specific? Okay, fine. Thank you. Hope no questions. Okay, so next one is mule deployed.properties, guys. In the mule deployed.properties, so the first option is the redeployment enabled true. So what is the meaning of this? So suppose I deployed an application, okay, so I changed something in the middle of that. So okay, so that time again no need to redeploy the application, guys. That will automatically redeploy. That is the use of this actually. So something, my application is already deployed, so I changed some content in the middle, I just save it. Whenever you change the application, automatically so redeployment happened, no need to do again manually redeploy. So that is the use of that. So next one is encoding.
So Venkat, I have one question. It will automatically deploy if we save the project?
Yes, that's what I will try to show you.
So do we, do we recommend in real time?
Yes, recommend that. Because every time, so sometimes, it will
start. Yeah, we do not want to deploy that process. This we wanted to keep the changes in our local light, but.
See, now I deployed, my application is automatically deployed now. Just drag and drop the some content here, HTTP drag and drop. And then some payload also deployed. Or else I just skip this. I will try to explain, guys, no worry, on HTTP everything I will explain properly. I'm just testing purpose and here. See, some changes are there. You can see the star symbol here, right? So go here, there is a save all and save is there. And just click the save all. It should redeploy. See, automatically redeploying happened. I'm not doing anything actually. Something is gone wrong, I guess. So automatically redeployment happened actually. Okay, so that is the use of that redeployment. So coming back to your question. So can you repeat your question?
Yeah, in real time, do we recommend making
yes,
as if
yes, true? Obviously we'll recommend. No? So that is a use actually. So why? Because see, if you stop and doing some changes, again we need to redeploy it actually. So see, it's quickly you can see the change, right? Whatever you did, it will take some time again redeployment, right? So you can see the difference also. So if you redeploy it, it will take less time actually. Whatever the change that will compile only that change. So what happened exactly when you deploy your application? First, it will compile whole changes, right? Whole logic, whatever you written in the XML, it will all the things it will compile. After that, it will deploy, right? But if you redeploy it, whatever the change you did it, right? So that will compile and again it will deploy. Actually, that will take less time. So but sometimes while doing changes, it's better to stop your server because any points today have still some issues actually. It's get hanging actually. That's why while doing your changes, just if you do the complex logic and all actually, if you have small changes then no issue actually. If you're doing any complex changes then so sometimes your any points today will get stuck actually. I was facing that issue. That's why I recommended while doing the changes, just stop your server, then redeploy it. That's what I'm trying to say. If it is a little bit changed, then no need to stop your server actually. Okay, so that is the thing. I'm coming back to here. You are clear, right? SRC main app folder, you are clear. And then we will deploy our property. Some more things are there here. This encoded is UTF-8. Okay, and again config resources in the sense, so here I have two XML files. One is mule-demo.xml, another one is test.xml. So automatically it will come here, guys. Suppose tomorrow you are going to add one more XML, that will also come here with comma separated. You understood, right? So like this it will come automatically. There is a config resources. If it is not coming here, so we can't identify that XML, guys. Suppose you are creating one more XML here, okay, one more configuration XML. So test2 I kept it. So if it is not coming into the mule deployed properties, okay, see now see here it's not coming here. So if it is not coming here, so we'll get a file not found kind of thing actually. When it will come here actually, generally whenever you are trying to deploy, that time it will come here, guys. I'm trying to deploy this application. See, automatically coming here. Earlier it is not there. I just try to redeploy it. I just try to deploy my application. That time it will come here actually. So what I'm trying to say here exactly, if it is not coming here, so it's a out of scope actually. So you are trying to operate on that, it will say clearly there is no test2.xml. It will say like that. So that's why, in worst cases, sometimes it won't create it. Then you have to go back and check it here, mule deployed properties. So if it is there or not, if it is there, if it is not there also sometime, you can keep it manually also, no issue. Okay, so that is a use of that view deployed our properties file is. That is a first package, that is src main app. In that you can keep it all the XML files, means our logic. So next one is mule app.properties, another one is mule deploy.properties. Okay guys, any questions on the first folder? Sudhakar and Tirish, anybody have questions? Okay, Sudhakar and Tirish.
Yeah, ask
Tirish. If you have any questions, you can ask guys. This is whatever the topic you are discussed, that topic you can ask. Out of topic, if you have any questions, end of the session we'll discuss. No issue. Tirish, go ahead.
So here we create a 3.xml file.
Yes.
So we call this view the same .xml file any number of times?
No. No. We should not create. It should be unique.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, thank you.
So Venkat, I have one question. How we know the suppose a developer change the code and now we wanted to I wanted to change the code, how we know which runtime server he used? 3.7, 3.8, how I know?
Yeah, good. So here you can see, here you can see the bracket na, mule project.xml mule server 3.8.3 enterprise edition. Can you see?
Okay.
Here you can see directly. You can change the version also. Suppose sometimes you are going to migrate it, right? Migrate it, right? Suppose whatever I was saying in session, so somebody working on 3.5.0, so they want to migrate it, first they have to add the server actually. So here, whenever you add the server, list of servers, it will come here, runtime servers. You can choose that. So whatever the enhancement, whatever the errors, obviously some errors will get it, right? Some old to new because of some old or some deprecated some content. So that type of issues will get it, right? So that we need to resolve manually. After changing the server, we'll get some issues. That red symbol will get top of this. So we have to go on there. What was the issue? We need to check it. We have to work on that. We can change directly here actually. You can see clearly version also in the mule project.xml. In the bracket, what version they implemented the project, you can see here actually. Okay. So that is the first folder. So coming to next folder guys, that is a src main API. Okay, src main API. This src main API, so in future we'll create a RAML projects guys, API related projects. Okay, so when I create a RAML projects means API project, so that time you will create we need to create these files guys. One is RAML, we need to create. Under the RAML we need to create schema file. Okay, and then if you create a schema, so then we need to create sample example files also. That is input.json might be example file. Similarly output.json, how we are expecting output, how we are expecting input, the type of examples we need to keep it actually. So what was the purpose of this RAML actually? Suppose when I create in a project, some validations we need to keep it guys, validations, and then document also we need to create it, documentation purpose and that validation purpose we need to create a RAML. This is only for REST APIs. Okay, so if we create a RAML and then schema, so this input.json output.json is what exactly? Suppose you are trying to publish your service, means exposing your service, somebody trying to call your service, right? So if it is a get request, you are just giving the data actually. Whenever they are trying to get the request, so you are giving the information to them. Suppose if it is a post request, okay, post request, they have to send some information. If it is a post, they have to send some information actually. So that time you will get some JSON file. Okay, that JSON file we need to validate it guys, is it properly there or not? Okay, is that any issues in the JSON or else any whatever you are expecting? Suppose we are expecting some mandatory field, optional fields. So even mandatory fields also some return type is we are expecting. That is properly there or not, we written in the schemas actually. That whole stuff, whole content, we have to keep under SRC main API, guys. That is the purpose of this folder, SRC main API. You are clear? So whatever the RAML created, RAML file and then schema file, whatever the example you are going to create, example in the sense, so generally we need to share that how you are expecting that input. Suppose I created one API, okay, some source will trying to call it, so mule API. So this is a MuleSoft API already created. Somebody trying to trigger, suppose think like this, I exposed as a post request. This is a post request in the sense, so we are expecting some data from the client, or else you can say source. So I'm expecting data, okay, I'm trying to insert into the destination, okay, so that's why I'm expecting some data. So they have to send to Mule. Mule will talk to the destination, then once you created, this will go come back and again update to the source or else client. So this time, so they have to send the information. Suppose here they are sending some JSON file or else XML file. So if they send JSON file or XML, so we should validate it actually. Otherwise, see whatever they are sending, so blindly we should not pass it actually. We have to validate it, because first we need to validate is that proper genuine client or not. First we should validate it. So once that is done, so then whatever the content they are sending, that content also we should validate it, guys. So for that purpose we are using RAML actually. So the validations and then documentation also. So documentation in the sense, so how this guy will know what data he have to send, what format he have to send, that we have to tell them in the documentation manner. Okay, this documentation will tell to the client, so what JSON we are expecting. In the JSON also, what are the mandatory fields we are expecting, what are the optional fields. In the mandatory fields also, what data type we are expecting. Clearly RAML, in the RAML there is a documentation, is there. That documentation we need to share to the source. Based on that, he will send, guys. So that is the use of this documentation and validation. So coming to here, in the SRC main API, whatever you are talking just now, this whole content we need to keep under SRC main API. That is the purpose of that folder. Clear?
Yeah.
Thank you. So next one is SRC main Java. There is another folder called SRC main Java. So in the SRC main Java, sometimes guys, so we'll use some Java classes actually. Java transformers, Java components, we'll use it. So that time, whatever the Java file you are using, that Java we have to keep under SRC main Java path. That is the use of the Java. Okay, whatever the Java classes you want to create it, right click on the SRC main Java, then create a class. There is an option called class. Just create a Java, so then keep that will go under SRC main Java. Then wherever you want, just call the Java class, so that will come whole path. So that obsolete path will come, we can place here. So then we have to work accordingly. So this folder contains only for Java classes. So next one is SRC main resources, guys. So this SRC main resources, first of all, by default log4j2.xml will come, guys. So this, if you want to do any changes, you can change it actually. How it will work exactly, first of all, it will create a log file, guys, in the server, muledemo.log file. Okay, so if you want to change this log file name, you can change here, and then based on this syntax how it will work, every 10 MB it will create a new file, guys. Now it is a mule demo.log. Okay. After 10 MB reach the size of the mule demo.log, it will create a mule demo 1, 2, 3, 5 like that. So here a rollover strategy 10 actually. So until 10 it will create it. Okay, after that my bit will delete it. Again it will create 1 to 10 like that. Okay, that is the use of this. So if you want to do any changes, you can change this on the log4j.xml. That is a by default it will get it. So next one is, that is, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, if we increase the size of this file, is any performance issue we get?
No, it's not related to performance. It will use hard disk space, your disk space actually.
Yeah.
No issue. Okay. Next one is, yeah, so under SRC main resources, log4j2.xml is there. So for this actually internally jar file also will come, guys. No need to add it, add the jar file. How log4j will work, so we need to add external jar file called, so log4j dependency is there, right? Generally in Java we need to add that log4j, but here automatically it will come, it will taken care by your application. So next one is, other thing you will place here under the resources, whatever the static content you are going to use it actually, that static content you can keep it. That is one thing. Suppose in your application I am using some images or else some XML files or else JSON files, right? You can keep it here actually. So, and one more thing is the external files like dev.properties, plot.properties, qa.properties, all the properties file, you can keep it under the resources. See, whatever the content you want to use in the project, right, that whole content, so if required content, you can keep it into the main resources, that is a placeholder. Okay, so next one is SRC main visual, guys. So using this, now if you see here, this example is, we are publishing the application, right? We are exposing the application. Sometimes we have to consume it, guys. Some third party people exposed API, we need to consume it, right? So that time there is a two ways, guys. One is SOAP related, another one is REST related. Two types of web services we have to use. One is SOAP, another one is REST. If you go for SOAP, guys, Sudhakar and Nitish, you can able to understand, right? This actually terminology related to web services. So we have two types of web services in the market. One is SOAP and then REST, guys. So when you go for a SOAP, there is a file called Wizard. When you go for a REST, there is it's a URL based actually. So web services, these are Java related web services actually. SOAP. So this SOAP and REST. So what is this exactly? So guys, I have a multiple projects integration. We are trying to integrate a multiple systems. That is, here I have an application A, and then I have one more application called, in the middleware we are using MuleSoft. I have one more application called App B. Two applications I have. So here I want to integrate these two applications, application A and application B, via MuleSoft. So how it will integrate it? So applications, whatever the application, how will integrate it? Using web services concept, guys. Using web services concept. These are two types of web services in the market. One is POST, another one is REST. Okay, so here coming to POST, in the POST there is a file called WSDL, guys, WSDL. So there is a web service description language. Okay, so if suppose I want to integrate these two applications via MuleSoft using SOAP. So that time this guy, application B guy, should expose or else should publish this WSDL file, guys. There is a web service, a description language. This is a format of XML actually, that WSDL contains what method is exposing, what logic he is exposing, whole content is there under WSDL file that he should expose actually. So now application A is trying to integrate to application B. So this time MuleSoft is the middleware. So this app B guy, application B guy should share that WSDL to the MuleSoft. Okay, so now where you keep this WSDL file under MuleSoft, that is the location of this SRC main WSDL file, because based on the WSDL only we are trying to talk this guy. We don't have other choice actually. He is exposed as a WSDL. That WSDL we need to keep under MuleSoft. Suppose if there is no MuleSoft, think like this guys, that way also, there is no WSDL here, there is no MuleSoft here, then how we talk? This directly, this WSDL shared to this guy, shared to application A. Okay, then so based on this WSDL file, he will generate some Java content, Java code. Okay, so that is nothing but a client code, you can say. The client code you need to send. This guy shared, this application B guy shared this WSDL file. Based on the WSDL, this guy should generate a client code. So once you generate a client code, whatever the code here, right, that automatically it will generate here. So that there is a command in the command prompt. You can type the command, automatically the code is generated at application A side. So based on that, he will talk to the application B. But here, coming to our MuleSoft, no need to generate the client code actually. Okay, so that there is some other built-in components are there. We just drag and drop that. This WSDL, we need to pass that particular component, then it will be okay. Is that clear? So coming to here, SRC main WSDL files, these type of WSDLs, because he is already exposed as API, exposed as a service, that SOAP service, that WSDL we need to place under SRC main WSDL. You are clear guys? Any questions on this?
Yeah, but what about the REST?
Yeah,
but the REST doesn't have WSDL files.
Yeah, REST actually it's a URL based, right? So no need to maintain anything actually. So for that there is a separate components are there. There is a HTTP component is there in the middleware in the mail. So you can pass directly that remote URL in the HTTP. That is a simple. For that no need to maintain anything. It's a URL based, right? So coming back here, what is exactly difference between these two things, SOAP and REST? SOAP is based on the WSDL file, so means there is a documentation, you can say. So based on this WSDL file documentation, your client will react accordingly. But whereas in REST, it's a URL based, simply URL based calling actually. There is a HTTP component is there, in that we can pass the HTTP, that remote URL, you can get the content. Okay, but whereas in here, suppose now this guy exposed as a WSDL. That WSDL contents might be 100 objects. So tomorrow he is going to create 101 object. So whatever he shared earlier WSDL, that should not contain that 101 object. Again, what this guy we need to do? Again, he need to share a new WSDL every time. That is a problem here. That's why people are preferred every time REST only, not SOAP. You are getting right? So whatever the changes happen, the latest changes we need to share to every time this middleware, or else if you talk directly application A, this latest WSDL we need to pass to the application A every time. That is a problem. So that's why any changes happen, we need to create a latest WSDL, we need to share to other guy. If you are talking to the REST, so if you are changing your logic also, so no need to face any problem from the client side actually. It's because it's a URL based. So if you are changing any URL, that time only it will impact actually, otherwise it won't impact if you change any logic. So that is a thing. So here we'll place the SRC main WSDL. So only SOAP calls we have to keep that WSDL under here. For REST calls no need to keep anything here. So just simply drag and drop the HTTP connector, you can place that URL, whatever the URL they shared. So that is about SRC main visual. Next one is SRC test Java, guys. Here SRC test slash Java. Here we create SRC main Java, right? So that here SRC test, if you write any test cases like JUnit test cases, it's talking about not MUnit guys, functional test cases like JUnit also you can write it. That JUnit related thing you can keep it under SRC test Java. Okay, whatever the Java classes you are written, that related test cases you can keep it here actually. That's the functional test cases. So the other one is SRC test MUnit. This is the MUnit. So whatever you are written flows now, so here we written flows. That flows you can write MUnit. So this is talking about, this folder is talking about SRC main Java related test classes. But SRC test MUnit is talking about your flows. So some clients will ask MUnit also. That is a functional test cases, guys. So what is MUnit exactly? You write a file, guys. You written a one logic here. Okay, you written a one flow here. How will know is that working or not? Is that expected behavior or not? So once you deployed your application, then after that execution happened, then that time only we'll get to know is that working fine or not. Once you deploy, that time only you'll get to know. But think like this, you've done locally, but your client is not exposing their servers because high privacy, that is might be several reasons they won't expose as a servers, right? So then how will get to know your application is working or not? Anyway, in your local, based on the JT server, it will work. But so in the server also, it should work, right? But he is not exposing as a server. He is not sharing the server's information. That time, you need to write some MUnit test cases, guys. If your MUnit is working properly, so then your flow also will work. You understood, right? Guys, what I'm trying to say here, generally some of the UK clients, they won't share their server's information. Okay. If they share the server's information, once you done locally, you will deploy either QA or else some UAT, DAT, finally production will deploy it. So once you deploy it, you can get to know your application is working or not, right? But they are not sharing their servers. They're not sharing their server. What we'll know, we need to write MUnit test cases. We need to show them actually. Guys, this is working in MUnit clearly. So if you run the MUnit, it is giving green and it is giving 100% success, then it should work actually. Yeah, tell me your question. Somebody asking.
Is it almost like a test case?
It's a test case only.
So what information normally the MUnit gives?
See, generally how test cases will work. There is
normally we do some unit test cases, yes, like success.
You are aware of JUnit test cases, right? JUnit test cases, you are aware of it, right? You are talking about JUnit test cases, right? Normally means.
Yeah.
So coming to MUnit here. See, there is a flow A is there. Flow A is means that is our logic XML file. This flow A is expecting some input like a JSON file. Okay, output is again some okay. So unique ID will get it. Once suppose we are trying to insert into the SFDC, the SFDC will give 200 status code. Okay, once success happened, 200 status code and unique ID also it will give. I'm talking about only SFDC. Unique ID also it will give back. Okay, these two will get. You are giving input as a JSON. Okay, so then output is what? 200 and unique ID. So if it is you are deploying your application, you will get to know once executed, you will get the output clearly. But here we are not talking about that deployment. We are talking about MUnit thing. Now tell me, so here in this case we need to pass as an input as a JSON, we should get a 200. You know what was the input, you know what was the output, you know already. Okay, so remaining thing here in the MUnit, you call your flow A action, B based on the logic, we need to call flow A. Understood? So the flow A is A expecting what? Input as the JSON file it was expecting. Okay. Output should be 200 status. So for this we need to write a mInit. The test, you are also no need to create it also. The test case, the mInit test case automatically it will create, it will give some suit actually. mInit test case suit it will give. If you right click on this, you will see this. There is an option called mInit. So add mInit library to classpath. Here there is no flow actually. It will give configure mInit maven support and then actually mInit will come automatically, but in this specific application there is no code actually. So if it is a code, mInit automatically it will create a basic flow, it will create it actually. Basic flow in the sense, so how many flows are there? Suppose flow A we need to call it, right? That flow A is calling automatically it will create, but what we need to pass that. So generally if you deploy it, so through Postman or else through SOAP UI, you are passing the data, you will execute your flow, right? But here there is some components will support for passing the information. So there is some components will support to pass the information like message. Try to show other flow. I guess I didn't add it actually, it's not coming. So anyway, I will show that one. So here we'll pass that message component, whatever the information you need to pass that, right? So we need to hold that in the message, means hard-coded content we need to keep it. Then here once you get the result, there is a component called asset true component is there. In the asset true we need to write the code. If status code is 200 then it's success or else failed. That kind of thing we need to write it in the mInit actually. Means manually we need to pass the content. Once you get that, so anyway your flow is executing in the middle actually. Whatever you're writing there, so that will call the, it will execute whole flow. It will come back with the 200 status code or else failure code. So then we have to assert it actually. Assert true, assert false, that kind of components are there. If it is a assert true, then it is a success. We need to write a condition. If it is a equal to equal 200, then it will give true. So then like that, it will create a mInit actually. Once that will, whatever you are expecting, whatever you are writing condition, you are getting same content, it will give 100% green or else it will give error. We have a separate session guys about mInit also, we'll see clearly on that.
Okay.
So I'm talking about where it is, mInit demo. So there is a mInit guys, src main, and then here src test resources are there now. Whatever the resources contains for mInit, right? So here src main resources, whatever the content related to your logic, we have to keep it here. Whatever the content related to mInit, that we have to keep it under src test resources. So why they are segregated? Suppose sometimes, you know, while executing mInit, okay, so the resources, whatever the required resources, that will call from src test resources. No need to talk this file actually. Understood, right? So it won't disturb original content. So whatever the mInit related, that mInit related, it will talk only test resources file, not main resources file. Main resources file will use only your main logic, not mInit logic. mInit logic only talk to the mInit sub resources. That is a segregation. Okay. So next one is Java library. So mule server. That's it guys. That is the thing. So next one is mule project.xml. Here you can see the domain name and server runtime. So this is the structure of your mail project, guys. So any questions? So to
once project is done, coin development is done.
Hmm.
How we can get the normally in case of jar file, wire file, or
zip file? Here we'll get zip file. Right click on the application. So there is an option called export. Export. Here you can see under Mule there is an option called archive world file. You will deploy archive world file. Click here. Keep it some zip content. So attached project is not required actually. So if you want to keep it source also, you can keep it this file. So here we can store somewhere else. Suppose keep a .zip file, .zip.
Okay.
So that will create a zip file to some location. So then copy that zip file and then deploy that.
So this zip file contains all these yes. folders information?
Yes. What? So not, compiled, everything is there. Compiled information. If we keep it attached project sources, even source code also will go. That is generally not required. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
So that is the thing. Any other questions, guys? Nivas team, any other questions? You are clear, right?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks, guys. I will share the recording session. So go through it, please. So if you have any questions, we'll discuss tomorrow. Tomorrow onwards, we'll see the
I have gone to that what is it training.mulesoft.com. I signed up and I'm not getting any videos. Normally once 8 weeks completed we'll get the voucher for the certification.